Thank you, Mr. Sinha. And Vivek Debray, of course, is a hard act to follow. So forgive me if I don't sort of live up to his standards. Nevertheless, luckily, what I'm going to speak is completely different from what he was speaking. He was speaking about fundamental changes and long-term changes, whereas my book is more focused on what has happened and some of the fundamental changes in the security and foreign policy domain. So therefore, there are completely two different paradigms that we are talking about. Although ultimately, the end result is going to be the same, that if these changes are followed through, the changes that have been initiated, the change in approach, the change in the way foreign policy and security is viewed or has been handled by this government so far and is planned to be handled in the future, then we are in for a overhaul of the system, which has tended to be status quoist most of the time. And I'm again trying to give you a little bit of an overview of the book and then come to why this book was written. Some may say that you could have waited for 5 years at the end of the first term, you could have written what the government has done. But my sense was that many of these discussions, many of these decisions at the highest level, when you do some unexpected and some bold decisions are taken in security domain, they remain shrouded in secrecy for a long time. Mostly the facts come out maybe years later, maybe some decades later, when it's easy to airbrush memory and then make it a little more positive for yourself. The protagonists tend to do that most of the time. So I thought, let me do it when it's fresh, when it's in people's memory, and when people have discussed and debated about it. So I chose four or five major events in this government's tenure to begin with as episodes, and of course then expanded on them in terms of policy. So I had done many, and of course I gave up being a day-to-day journalist or a regular journalist in 2014, November 2014, exactly about 3 years ago. So I don't do reporting as I used to do earlier. So I had that luxury of a little bit of stepping back and looking at events from a distance, and maybe a little more, will call it a little more objectively than being involved in the day-to-day reporting. So although I had done some analysis, short-term analysis, some articles the follow-up, in the wake of these events like the surgical strikes in Myanmar and in JNK, and then the Pathankot, handling of the Pathankot attack, which was in January 2016. And then, of course, looked at how India's approach to the border management with China has also undergone a major change, major shift in its approach to border management with China, and looking up and standing up to the Chinese bullying there. So I thought that was the right time to do it. Initially, the thought was that we would do it in the third anniversary of the government. But by the time I got down to formalizing the structure in my mind and I got the access, and I must say that I've been very fortunate to have access to some of the people who are involved in this. The NSA is on record quoted extensively in the book, fortunately, because that's where it comes from, the horse's mouth. I mean, it's also, he also has given me an insight of what the Prime Minister thought about these decisions, how he came to the conclusion in terms of giving the orders for doing the surgical strikes, or looking at even the Pathankot attack, which he wasn't directly involved in the initial stages, but later came into it. So, as I said, I've benefited from the trust and confidence people at the highest levels, and some of them still holding very sensitive posts, reposed in me. I tell my young journalist trainees and friends who are starting out that this is something that I've learned over these 35 years that one has been a journalist, that if you keep trust over a long period of time, people will trust you over a longer period of time. And that has benefited me. I've known many of these people for over three decades, and therefore they were not hesitant to share what is normally a secret or a very secretive decision-making process. So that's how it began, and that's how it sort of turned out. The books sort of came out like that. And you will ask me, how is it different from the earlier governments, Modi's approach to security or foreign policy? And I'm not going to get into the details, like Vivek Debroy said, that you will not read my book at all if I give away everything. But what I've noticed as a common thread in the decision making, and of course by people who work closely with the Prime Minister, is that he does not get rattled by episodic ups and downs, which I hope every Prime Minister has that ability to do so. But in this case, it is very much evident that he does not get rattled by ups and downs, does not get pessimistic by setbacks. And there have been setbacks, let's face it, in Jammu and Kashmir, in terms of killings, in terms of setbacks in the left-wing extremism areas. But in none of those things, he seemed to have come to a hasty conclusion or a hasty decision from what I gathered from the people who are around him and who took the decisions. The other approach is, of course, again, all prime ministers are expected to do, but he does it much more often, that you will find the NSA being quoted here and some other people being quoted here, that he has, there's not a single meeting apparently when he does not bring a new dimension or a new innovative idea to the table. He has the right questions, he has the right approach, and but ultimately he leaves the decision the nitty-gritty and the execution of the idea to the professionals. So that has been one of the key findings that I've had in writing the, or researching the book. You will notice, and it may seem to be more a publicity ploy, and there are foreign policy experts in this room who have dealt with the subject much more than I have. That diaspora was always on the radar. We had the Pravasi Bharatiya Divas for a long time in India. But the way the Prime Minister has leveraged the diaspora around the world, and be it in small places like Fiji and Seychelles, and of course the US and the UK, and I've quoted senior diplomats like Mr. Parthasarathy and Satish Chandra, who say in their four decades plus experience, they have not seen this kind of use of the diaspora for taking India's stock higher in the geopolitics and international relations. So I think that was one major change that has come in. Also, the Prime Minister is very very particular, apparently, in dealing with sensitive issues like refugees, and also the Commander Jadhav case with Pakistan, or catching the people, the ISI modules that are being busted. Some 104 modules have been busted in the last 3 years, which is not on the radar normally, which is not spoken about in India. And so therefore, he is very particular that as a responsible rising nation, we should be much more ethical. I mean, we should be ethical, not much more ethical, but we should be ethical and responsible. We are a responsible nation. And therefore, the directions are very clear, and people have to sort of follow those directions very scrupulously. So the bottom line in all the decisions and the approach to national security and foreign policy has been India first. In one word, if I have to say that, or in two words, I have to say, it's India first. It's India's national interest, which all other nations, including the United States, still the preeminent power in terms of hard power and even economic power so far, although China is trying to catch up or sort of overtake. It, for the US, it's always its national interest which comes first. And all other superpowers before that have always looked at their national interest first. So this in India has been largely missing. We have always been tried to be good boys. We want people to appreciate us all the time. I think that is slowly and subtly changing. When it comes to taking hard decisions or taking decisions that are not palatable to our friends and our supporters, the Prime Minister's approach has been that let's not hesitate. If it's in national interest, if it supports India, then let's go ahead with it. So that's the India first approach, which I think has shown results, as you will see in the book. I've spoken about it. So what has been the two or three distinguishing features in the approach to national policy, national security policy? One, of course, it's very focused. The old turf wars amongst different agencies, intelligence agencies, are much reduced. I would not say completely eliminated, but much reduced. There is much more cohesion, not just synergy, but cohesion in the approach to national security amongst these agencies, including the three defense forces. Look at the way the left-wing extremism has been handled. On the surface, or on the face of it, you might think that, you know, what has changed? But I was just reading some report this morning. Again, somebody has said that the Maoists themselves have said that we have suffered setbacks and we are now down to looking at, you know, sort of being confined to only certain areas. Again, this has started in, I would say, in 2012, 2013, to be fair to the previous government, the approach to left-wing extremism. But in this government, there's been much more focused intelligence-based operations, intelligence-based approach to eliminating left-wing extremism, or at least the head, cutting the head off from the body. So targeting the leaders rather than just looking at killing the numbers. And the numbers have been huge. The elimination of the cadre, the Maoist cadres in those areas, that has been quite noticeable. If you look at the statistics, which is again there in the book, JNK, if you look at what exactly happened about more than a year ago when Burhan Wani was killed, and post that what happened in JNK, for about 6 months it looked like we are going back to pre-89 or pre-1990 days, 89-90 days in JNK. But look at this year again, from January to now, things have turned around. We don't no longer hear the stone pelting, we no longer hear the kind of agitation that was going on. Although some people will have a difference of opinion in the sense that is the hard approach good enough, but I think it needed to be brought back to some kind of semblance of normalcy, and the willingness to go against the well-entrenched vested interest. The NIA cracking down on the Hurriyat leadership for their illegal wealth and their hawala money that they were getting at the leadership again. If you look at the elimination of the top militant leadership in JNK, I think the number is something like 168 militants have been killed this year. Now, statistics are always not the correct way to gauge it, but out of those 168, I would say about 70 of them were the top leaders, and now they are adrift. The militancy in JNK is adrift. They don't know. There is no connection between the handlers in Pakistan or across in POK and the cadres. So therefore, the disruption in the militancy has been huge as far as JNK is concerned. So what does it indicate? It indicates that the willingness to use hard power is much more in this government, to my mind. I may be wrong. I mean, you may want to contest that. I've already mentioned cohesiveness amongst all agencies. Defense has been a slight disappointment to me, and I have written this in the book, that a good beginning was made in terms of policy changes, in terms of trying to infuse new energy into procurement, in terms of trying to simplify some of the procedures, giving importance to Make in India or to companies, what is called the IDDM project, the indigenously designed, developed and manufactured goods or manufactured weapon platforms. All that has been given. Unfortunately, it hasn't gone further than just the policy changes or tweaking of the policy, which there are several reasons. There are political reasons, there are bureaucratic reasons, and there are, of course, the resistance from the well-entrenched vested interest. But I'm hoping that with a full-time minister now, I know that she's got only 18 months to go or 17 months to go, but hopefully it will be back on track. I would have liked to have seen, and if you look at what the Prime Minister began with, his speech to the Combined Commanders Conference in December 2015, where if you look at the speech, and if even 50% of that was implemented or at least initiated, we would have had much more reforms in the defense sector, which has, as I said, has slowed down for various reasons. We had changes in the at the top as ministers. We had four ministers, if you look at Mr. Jaitley's two tenures. But that notwithstanding, there is a fundamental change in the way the the military as well as the civil bureaucracy is now being held to account, unlike earlier times. And I think that should manifest itself in coming years, although, as I said, it should have been speeded up. So that was something that is my one of my points of criticism as far as this government is concerned. But the way I think the legacy was left behind in defense, a toxic legacy, I would say, of not taking any decisions and complete paralysis in decision making, that has taken some time to be overturned and to make the turn around. So therefore, there has been some sort of slowdown in that decision making. But in internal security, touch wood, there has been no major attack except for JNK and parts of Punjab which are bordering JNK and Pakistan, which I think is a major achievement, because otherwise we've had a series of attacks in the main cities and other parts of India. As I said, many of these modules we don't get to know. They've been busted, they've been arrested. A lot of these financial transactions have been attacked. Fundamentally, I think I would sort of stop before I'll just show you some of the pictures that are there in this book, and why is it, for a journalist, that is always a big kick when you get everything ahead of others. And therefore, as a journalist, I'm happy with what I could get access to. Probably I'll expand this book in coming months when we get to the 4 years of this government. But at the moment, I think if I had to give marks to the government in terms of on the scale of 1 to 10, I would give them about 7.5 in terms of security and defense policy, mainly because, as I said, defense hasn't really played up to what we expected. There's been no reforms at the top as far as jointness is concerned, although we see some beginning of at least some reforms in terms of creating the two agencies, the cyber, the space, and I think the special forces, which I think today, again, somebody has written about it, although it started about 6 months ago. So all that is happening. So why this book, like these are some of the pictures of the special forces which went across POK. Now, people have asked questions. What is so different from earlier raids that used to be carried out by some of our army guys in JNK? The thing is that never in the history of India, in JNK, especially after the militancy began there, that this was actually authorized at the highest level. Ownership was not taken by the political leadership. It was always left to the local, maybe the battalion commander or the brigade commander, and said, you do it. In case you do it well, maybe we'll claim success. If it fails, we'll remain there. In this case, there was elaborate planning, elaborate discussions, options were considered, and finally a land attack or a special forces attack was authorized over an arc of 270 kilometers from Nowshera to Uri, and simultaneous raids on 7 different locations, killing about 75 to 80 terrorists and Pakistani soldiers co-located in POK. This is one of the camps of the in POK, where the terrorist launch pads are, where they are co-located with the army, the Pakistani army's posts, and this is how the layout was, and this was where all destroyed. There are 2 of those. I have not spoken much about China, but let me speak about China too. And before I come to that, now this is the map of Doklam or Dolam. Actually, it should be Dolam, the crisis, where the Chinese had sought to sort of start building that road. They had come up to this point in 2003, this point. And they were wanting to resume this road to come here to the Jhamperi Ridge, so that they can come down from here into India very easily. Now, all this had started from 1999. They were coming up. Nobody objected to it because it was considered to be in either the Chinese territory or in the disputed territory with Bhutan. Now, this is Tibet, this is north. I mean, just in case you are sort of not clear, this is north. And India says that this is the tri-junction where Sikkim, Bhutan and China meet, Batangla. China says that that is not the tri-junction, it is here. Gyamochen is the tri-junction, so which means they want to alter this ground situation and claim this area, so that this Dolam plateau will give them then the full access or easy access to this side is the Siliguri corridor. So India had has a post here called Dokala, which kept watching the first standoff between the Bhutanese and the Chinese, and then they intervened. Now this was again authorized very quickly from the top, and the Chinese expected a political or a diplomatic protest from Bhutanese for resuming this road or road building, but they never expected India would walk into what China calls its own territory, what India and Bhutan say is a disputed territory. They never expected India to go into this militarily to intervene in this area. So that is where they went, and actually the standoff began as early as May 21st or 24th is the picture I've got, although it was reported or sort of brought to light by the Chinese on 26th of June, the day Prime Minister Modi was in US, that day they chose to make it public. So more than a month after it had started. There was obviously a deliberate design to do it, but this is a UAV grab. You can see the Indian Army's UAV hovering over them, the Chinese and the Indians sort of amassed there. So this is how it began, and we stood firm. So the one line that was apparently used in the negotiations all the time was that India will be resolute on the border and reasonable in diplomacy. And again, a very unusual approach the Prime Minister adopted, that when he and Xi Jinping met at Hamburg for the G20 summit, they were in a lounge there, and when he saw, after everybody else had met President Xi Jinping, and Prime Minister being the Prime Minister, not the President, he was the last one who could have met him. So he just walked across to Xi Jinping with his delegation, two or three people, and he had about six people with him, and just shook hands. Now the Chinese are, as many of you will know, sort of always set on very hard protocol, and they do not talk about nitty-gritties, they don't talk about negotiations. But the Prime Minister apparently broke the ice and said that to President Xi Jinping, and I have quoted people who were next to the Prime Minister there, where he said that why are we fighting over a tactical issue when we have our strategic ties are much bigger. So let the two special representatives, that is the NSA on our side, Ajit Doval, and on their side, Yang Jishi, who is the counselor, let them handle it. Now apparently, President Xi Jinping was stunned for about half a minute, and he did not know what to say, because the Chinese leadership never comes into the negotiations. They always leave it to the officials or the younger or the lower lot. So he was forced to agree, and from there the kind of ice was broken. It began. And it took almost 38 to 40 meetings between our diplomats, the two sides' diplomats, to resolve this crisis. But this was not the first one that India had actually stood up to China on the border. But it was all, there was another incident in September 2014 when President Xi Jinping arrived in Ahmedabad, when he and Prime Minister were on that swing in Ahmedabad. The PLA had intruded with 1,000 troops into a place called Chumar, which is the southernmost area of Ladakh, south eastern Ladakh, and there when they came, India also responded, unlike what happened in Debsang previously, about 18 months previously or 15 months previously in April 2013, India built up against 1,000 or 1,500 PLA troops. India rapidly, in 2 days or overnight, actually in 48 hours, built up a troop strength of 9,000 people facing the Chinese. They've never faced this before. We have always said, okay, you've come in, stand there, stay there, we will diplomatically resolve it. Now here, India said, no, we will stop you there. If you build a force of 1,500, we'll get you 9,000 people. So overnight, 9,000 troops were built up. And I've quoted extensively the brigadier who was in charge of that. I've quoted the people who were involved there. And then President Xi was told in Ahmedabad by Prime Minister that this is not good for our relationship. Will you order them to go back? Although it still took two weeks more for the troops to go back. But again, this was a change in the approach. Earlier, we would accept that the Chinese will come in, they'll sit down, and then negotiations will resolve it. So there is a additional element that was brought into negotiation, that you will stop them physically, militarily, and then look at negotiations. Nobody is abandoning negotiations, but at least, and this was another incident which actually broke the ice. One young lieutenant of the Chinese PLA tried to cross the human wall, human chain that was formed by the Indians, slipped and fell, and then he was returned to the Chinese. So that broke the ice that time in Chumar in 2014. So that was the approach, and of course we know what happened after that. They're going to be still there in Dolom. India's people have asked, what did India gain in the Dolom resolution? All that India wanted was, if you go back to the map, was to stop the construction of the road, because it is disputed. It was decided in 2012 that we will not alter the ground situation until all three countries agree. So India has stopped this road construction. They have gone back to, on their side, to this place. They've camped here still in these areas, and there's Yatung, of course, this side, where there's a big town which they're trying to connect to these areas. All that will continue to happen. So all the reports that you're seeing afterwards, that the troops are still there, certainly the Chinese troops are there, and so are the Indian troops. In fact, India has increased the presence here now in these areas, really. So that's not the point. The point was that you had to force that resolution, or at least the disengagement. Then I have Pathankot. Pathankot was a lot of misconceptions about Pathankot, that the NSA was directing operations from here, and he was minute-to-minute intervening. All that is a blow-by-blow account of the people, the NSG people who were involved, the CNC of the Air Force, who was personally present there, the Lieutenant General KJ Singh, who was the Western Army commander. All those people have given the entire blow-by-blow account, and therefore, I think it will be instructive to go through that chapter for the kind of quick decision-making. Although India knew that some group of four terrorists were already inside India, nobody knew their exact location. And because a preemptive action was taken, even when they got into Pathankot, which is a 2,000-acre area, we have Marshal Inamdar here, he'll tell you, is a 2,000-acre base with 25-kilometer perimeter compound. They had got in, but then once the first contact was made, and unfortunately one Air Force commando, Garud, Gursevak Singh, was martyred there, after that, they were confined to 250 meters by 250 meters area. If you compare that attack with other attacks in Anuradhapura or in PNS Kamran and Mairan in Pakistan, or on Afghanistan, US base in Afghanistan on the Camp Bastion, India did not lose a single aircraft, no strategic assets were lost, no hostages were taken, and yet Pathankot was deemed, if you go into the media reports of that time, that it was deemed a failure, which is a complete misrepresentation of what exactly happened. So therefore, I have tried to correct that impression. Again, this gentleman, bless his soul, Lieutenant General E.K. Niranjan of the NSG, is a bomb squad commander. He is now taking out the bodies of the three terrorists who were killed in this area. And he is following the standard operating procedure of using a stick to pull the body, drag the body, and so that, you know, if there is any booby trap, it'll get blasted. It doesn't happen, and unfortunately, this is minutes before he dies. He's martyred because the body is lying down there, this terrorist, and this body of his goes a little bit 10 meters away, and he opens this dead terrorist's pocket and takes out a grenade which is booby trapped, and it sort of explodes in his hand, and he gets killed, he gets martyred. But the reports that time, if you see, and especially, he's a friend of mine, but one gentleman wrote a report that this fellow was trying to take a selfie with the dead terrorist and was therefore martyred, and he was not following the procedure. Which again, I thought it's my duty to correct that perception, because he did not do that. He was actually very brave in doing what he was doing. So all that, you can see the energy. There are so many pictures there. I don't want to sort of preempt that book. But that is how it was, all these operations happened. Then there are other small little revelations about India's base that India is building, two bases, naval bases, I would say, or turnaround bases in Assumption Island in Seychelles and the Agalega, North Agalega Island in Mauritius in the Indian Ocean. So if we think that only China is doing something in Djibouti, not true. India is also doing something in various places. So it's a beginning of a change, beginning of a turnaround. So therefore, the book is not an analytical document. Read it for what it is. It may be incomplete in some matters, in some aspects, but at least it's a beginning of giving out the details of decision-making process. And therefore, I thought I'll write this book. but we can discuss further in case you have any sort of criticism or any other point of view, we will discuss that. But I'll stop here. Thank you very much.
You just didn't realize that half an hour has gone by. I think what makes Nitin's book a must read is, as he himself mentioned it, but he also slightly in his own inimitable way downplayed it. He had access to the key players, to the key actors, and to the key decision makers. And therefore, there's nothing that he has added on to what he has received. In that sense, it's an exemplary narrative of actually what went on the ground, undiluted by any bias or any agenda whatsoever. Really, thank you so much. I thought we could actually really have another session on this also, but I'm really happy that all of us could get a bird's eye view of what you have really put into that work. Thank you so much. So, do